Welcome everyone to the second day of our Freedom of the Press conference and the second of the two structural fixes panels, where we will talk about the various policy levers that are available to us to try to see if we can protect and reinvigorate the press function, whether it be antitrust law, tax law, the law of nonprofit entities, government funding, data privacy regulation, regulation of social media and search engines, and any other potential options for supporting and enhancing the press functions and its institutions. My name is Scott Shapiro. I teach at Yale Law School. And I am really pleased to have with us today on our panel, one, Lina Khan, who is the Associate Professor of Law at Columbia Law School, Steve Waldman, the President and Co-Founder of Report for America, and Ethan Zuckerman, the Associate Professor of Public Policy, Communication Information, and the Director of the UMass Institute for Digital Public Infrastructure. Welcome. Yesterday we talked about the problems, which we're trying to fix with our structural fixes. But before talk about, the right solution to the problem, I want to talk again about the diagnosis of the problem. Here's a very simplistic take on the problem. And tell me if this is what you think, whether this is the only problem or there are other problems there. But here's a very simplistic take on the problem facing journalists, journalism and the press in the internet age, which is that newspapers were this product that bundled together lots of information that most consumers weren't particularly interested in. Some people were interested in the weather, some people were interested in sports, some people interested in entertainment, some people are interested in classifieds. Some people were interested in the news and in particular local news, but that wasn't like a huge percentage. It's just that newspapers made you buy the local news and world news if you wanted to get the sports and entertainment and all the other stuff. But with the internet, as Jack Balkin has often said, the internet is like the universal solvent, and it dissolved this bundle. So now you can get you can get your news from ESPN, you can get your classifies from Craigslist or whatever. You can get entertainment news from TMZ. You don't need to buy the newspaper anymore to get what you want. So really the problem here is the fact is a demand problem. People really aren't that crazy about reading the news. It's just that they were forced to buy something that had the news in it before the internet. Now with the internet, you don't need to do that anymore. So if that's the problem, it's a problem of demand, and it's not clear how to solve that problem. That's a simplistic take. Is this the right take? I'm gonna first ask Lina what if she has anything to add to it.
Great, thanks so much for having me. It's great to be here with such a fantastic panel. And I apologize, I was not able to make yesterday's structural fix panel, so there may be some repetition. I guess I see the problem slightly differently, or at least would place emphasis on some different factors. So one is the fact that news distribution now is controlled primarily by a very small number of companies. So namely Facebook and Google, which, you know, a huge number of Americans rely on those platforms to access news. Those same platforms have also managed to control news monetization, given that they've also captured control over the digital ad market. And Google in particular has integrated itself across the entire ad tech supply chain. And so there are all sorts of conflicts of interest that it's able to exploit in order to siphon away even more revenue from the publishers. And so what you have here is a situation where these platforms that are controlling access to news and whose unilateral decisions are determining what news is or is not seen are also directly competing with the publishers for ad revenue through their own ad-based surveillance business models. And so I think that situation in aggregate creates all sorts of perverse incentives. And so I see the problem partly as being one of outsized horizontal control, partly of vertical integration, and partly also the fact that these digital platforms are running on behavioral ad-based business models, which both perverts their incentives vis-a-vis what types of news and content to amplify, and then also places them in direct competition with the publishers that are so dependent on them. So I see those as some of the key problems in addition to the ones that you mentioned.
Right, so this is that there's not only is there weak demand for journalism, but the funding model has of kind of advertising based revenue, it runs headlong into this kind of duopoly where these major platforms are siphoning off like the precious revenue of the news organizations.
Yeah, I'm not sure that I would entirely buy the demand side problem in the same way. I think thinking about the market structure and the business model and the role of government in shaping the architecture in which news is produced and distributed, I think those factors having changed so significantly have potentially also then fed into the demand issue. But
actually, that's great, because I'd like to get back to that, the demand issue, when we start talking about solutions, but that was really helpful. Ethan, anything to add?
Sure. So look, there's this long history of journalism being supported by the market, and not just perhaps the golden age of much of the 20th century, but certainly going back historically through American history. You know, we've had commercial newspapers going back to before the formation of the Republic. One of the things that happens in that history, actually, that people forget is that we also had really heavy subsidies. The existence of those newspapers was essentially possible through most of the 18th and 19th centuries through massive postal subsidies, where first-class mail was subsidizing the distribution of journalism, where exchange copies were making it possible for journalists to share information back and forth. So we tend to idealize this market-based system. We tend not to recognize that historically it's actually been a heavily subsidized market. And one of the things that we should be doing is looking beyond our own borders and realizing that solutions to this may not inevitably be market-based solutions. But in addition to that, so signaling that I'm going to be pushing for public media, that I'm going to be pushing for different sorts of subsidy around here, this is not just a financial structure struggle, it's also an attention struggle. So Lina is absolutely right. The market is now dominated by a small group of what I tend to think of as discovery engines. That's really what Google and Facebook have in common. They direct enormous amounts of attention. And because they're able to direct that attention, they bundle the advertising with it. So in the same way that newspapers used to bundle together the news that you wanted to read with the news that you really didn't care about, but it was important for society that it happened, and some ads, Google, Facebook, et al. Do the same thing. They've captured your attention by directing you to what you wanted to pay attention to, and they're throwing some ads in along for the line. You actually can't solve this problem without solving this larger ecosystem problem. So it is not just that news is getting starved of finances, it's also getting starved of attention, because now what's going on is everyone is sort of competing for this scarce supply of attention. It is a marketplace that is somewhat rigged, right? You're actually much better off if you're Facebook, if you can keep people within your own ecosystem, Google to keep people within the Google and YouTube ecosystem. Even if people were clamoring for the sort of high quality news, you have counter incentives to sort of do it. the way that I think you get out of this ultimately is by taking on not just financially and attention-wise revitalizing journalism, but thinking about the larger ecosystem, which includes social media, search engines and such. You actually have to start looking at that whole complex from journalism to discovery to discussion, and looking at that as a critical infrastructure for civics that we should be treating at least in part as a public good. And I feel certain that I can talk at length about this, but that's sort of the modification that I want to give to your problem statement.
Actually, that's so helpful. So Lina mentioned kind of the market structure. You mentioned two additional points. One is that the market for news never really worked in the kind of standard competitive way. It was always subsidized in various forms by various entities, the state and the like. But also, it may be true that people don't love journalism, some people love journalism. I love journalism, right? It's just the issue is like how many people out there, is it enough to support enough journalism that we need? That's really the question. And one of the points that you were making, if I understood it correctly, Ethan, is the idea that these platforms are drawing our attention even further away from what we, from a public good perspective, ought to be reading. We're being led away from other things. So it's kind of like eroding the demand side even further.
So what I'm really trying to say in this is sort of imagine an Italian model where you have a very heavy subsidy for high quality journalism. And where you have, you know, a journalism space that's taking direct government money to keep a diversity of voices alive and online, you still have a problem, which is that even with a diverse press space, it's possible that no one is paying any attention to it. What I would say is people love conversation. And historically, those conversations have included news, current events, and civics. They've included politics, they've included sports, they've included any number of other things. Certainly when you go back to the 18th and 19th centuries, those conversations in no small part center on the newspaper. And the newspaper doesn't need to own the conversation, it can be the spark for the conversation. As we shift into the late 20th and 21st century, suddenly the people who are hosting those conversations, those people who are hosting the opinion, the back and forth, the social discourse, they also have control over monetizing attention. And that's the struggle here, right? It's not just that newspapers are shrinking, it's that there's now all sorts of different spaces to have conversation, all sorts of different prompts for conversation, and the ways of monetizing that conversation that frankly, in many cases, are pulling journalism out of the equation entirely. So the big point I just want to emphasize is that I think people make a terrible mistake when they just try to save journalism. I think what you actually have to look at is public spheres as a whole and the civic and non-civic conversation, because unless you get the business model and sort of attention flow models right around that, you run that risk of saving journalism that nobody reads and no one talks about.
Right. Okay. That was super helpful. Thank you. Steve, do you you want to jump in?
Yeah, I think first of all, the crisis isn't the press. The crisis is local press. Not that there aren't problems with the press, but the most severe issues that we're talking about tend to be around local news ecosystems. And while I agree with a lot of the analysis about demand side issues, the main reason that the news business models collapsed was not losing readers, it was losing advertisers. It was the internet providing other means for advertisers to do what they needed to do. And that, by the way, started happening before Google and Facebook became a force. the FCC report that I authored, which came out in 2011, was all about the collapse of local news. Google and Facebook were barely even a factor at that point. It was already happening because different parts of the classified business were going to, you know, were going to monster.com or Craigslist or The Knot or things like that. And then the second wave happened with Google and Facebook that, you know, is a real serious thing. And the truth is that in a lot of communities, local news is actually still has a lot of attention. You know, this is, New York Times isn't really a great example, but it's the easiest one to find. You know, in the golden age of you know, before the internet had its effect, New York Times circulation was 1.1 million. Now its digital circulation is 5 million and it has 153 million uniques. It is actually has a much bigger audience than it did in the golden age of its business model. Now, and smaller versions of that happen in communities. And there are all sorts of examples of local newspapers or local TV stations that have an audience that's just as big as they had before and about a tenth of the revenue or a very dramatically. So that leads to these, the business model crisis that we have. And the crisis is severe because putting aside whether it's demand, putting aside whether it's a civic good, we can start with the basic understanding that it's a real threat to democracy, that the immune system of democracy is weakened. We have thousands of news deserts. We have another thousand or so of ghost newspapers that might as well be news deserts because they're not providing important civic information. And we need to look at that as this very severe crisis for democracy, not only because of accountability, the lack of accountability, but also as it relates to misinformation and polarization. You know, the vacuums that are being created in these areas are being filled. They're being filled by, you know, by disinformation and polarization. So I think that there's elements of truth to the demand side diagnosis, but as a practical matter, what really broke the business models was what the internet did to the advertising business of local news.
So let me just stay on this for a second, Steve, because I know you've worked on this topic, but if the business model was broken by the internet even before Google and Facebook, how do we explain why these hedge funds keep on gobbling up these newspapers?
Like, why do they bother if it's such a lousy business?
Yeah.
Okay, I was puzzled by this too. So I kept asking because it's, you know, it's a good question. And the reason is that a hedge fund is a short-term business. They're buying these as short-term investments. It's actually different than even, you know, a big newspaper chain, why they would buy a newspaper. They might also cut, you know, staff and stuff, but they do it with a theory about how this is going to work out well in the long run, that this is going to, you know, reduce the cost structure and we'll end up with a sustainable business in the long run that's going to make us a lot of money 5 years from now as well as that. Hedge funds don't look at it that way. They look at it as what's the cash flow that this could generate right now and maybe next year. And the truth is you can cut newspapers to the bone and there's a sort of inertia to the revenue where you could cut it 70% and the revenue drops 20% and you can generate some nice cash flow out of that for a couple of years and then it dies and they move on to something else. So that's the key thing about understanding the hedge fund motivation in acquiring newspapers is that it's a totally rational, but very short-term calculation.
Sure. Thank you. So Lina, if the problem is market structure, or if one big part of the problem is market structure, what do we do about it?
Well, I want to note that I think Ethan's point is a really important one, which is, yes, we've in part relied on the market, but never exclusively relied on the market for news production and distribution. And I think especially, you know, the mention of the postal service subsidies and all sorts of ways in which government was in the business of, yes, ensuring that the market was working, but also making sure that news was being able to be produced outside of the market as well. Within the market structure problem, I mean, I think Steve's point is a good one, that, you know, the advent of the internet created alternative places where advertisers would go. But the fact is, advertisers are going to go where there are eyeballs. And so if there is actually demand for local news, then I think even local news providers could be attracting, you know, local advertisers. And so I do think that, yes, we may need, you know, a lot of non-market incentives there as well, but I don't think that the business model is intrinsically, you know, dead there. In terms of, you know, what are the tools? So I think there are a variety of ways in which we could seek to loosen the dominance of these horizontal platforms. So the fact that the Google and Facebook are, you know, one of the key ways in which people are accessing news. That could look like a few things. I mean, traditionally we've relied on remedies like interoperability, horizontal breakups. I think it does require a little bit of analysis relating to the source of the power that these firms have. And so in the case of Google, there's been some recent research showing that one reason why Google's been able to dominate online search is because it's been able to dominate the crawling function. So crawling the entire web basically is somewhat of a natural monopoly function. And so by capturing crawling, it's been able to capture the index and capture, you know, online search. So if you open up the crawling function and make that, you know, something like an essential facility that other rival engines have access to, that's a world in which you may have more search engines. Each search engine can decide on its business model. It can decide on the algorithm by which it wants to sort. And so you could have more plurality that way. We could also look to the digital ad ecosystem and how to, you know, either engender more competition or root out some of the conflicts of interest that are creating the perverse outcomes there. The recent complaint filed by the Texas State AG, as well as a whole bunch of other AGs, really detailed in quite striking ways the specific moves that Google had taken to actually ensure and exacerbate the information asymmetries in these markets between Google and between the publishers and advertisers. And so there are a whole bunch of ways that you could try to ensure that that market is more fair, that Google does not have a position both in running the exchange for the purchase and sales of ads, and then also have a position on the buy side and also have a position on the sell side, right? Which is something we prohibit in other markets like
stock. Actually, can you talk about this? Because I think this is a very important aspect of the way these platforms work, is that they seem to be both platforms and competitors at the same time. And could you just talk about that for a second, because it is quite, at least to me, disturbing.
Yeah, and I mean, the ad tech supply chain is quite complex and technical, so I'll do my best. But basically, you know, Google and Facebook make revenue by selling ads, but they also control the underlying technology that news publishers rely on in order to sell ads. And so you have a situation where Google is both providing the tools for, you know, the New York Times, the Wall Street Journal, a bunch of smaller newspapers that, you know, that those publishers are using Google's tools, but Google is also competing with the New York Times and with the Wall Street Journal for ad dollars. Another part of the dynamic here is that what previously used to be the case was that the Wall Street Journal and the New York Times had exclusive access to information about their audiences. But the fact that Google both controls these tools and then also controls so much of the plumbing of the web, Google now has, you know, equal access to that information. And so that's really upended the dynamics where Google both has, you know, in some cases, superior access to information about the New York Times and the Wall Street Journal's audiences. And then it was also able to compete with them for ad dollars. And so I think that's the core dynamic. And then the fact that Google in particular is integrated all across the supply chain of the purchase and sale of ads means that there are just layers and layers of conflicts of interest and information asymmetries. The recent complaint by Texas actually alleged that Google and Facebook had colluded. So there was a moment in time where Facebook was actually about to introduce alternative technologies for advertisers and publishers, and Google recognized that as a threat. And so they ended up basically agreeing to give Facebook certain types of speed and information advantages in order to get Facebook to back off from introducing that rival technology. Those are some of the dynamics there.
Which... That was really helpful and clear and just really disturbing that this is the situation. Do we have any sense of so in order to approach this problem, it doesn't seem to me necessary to go drastic and say, well, we have to break up Facebook, we have to break up Google. There are less drastic policy responses. One of them could be just simply what you've been talking about, which is ensuring that if you're gonna play the platform, you can't also be a competitor on that platform. How would legally that be accomplished? Like, what would need to happen to prevent that from happening? Some kind of consent decree from a court, some ruling from the Federal Trade Commission? Like, how would that go about?
Yeah, so historically, these types of rules have been pursued through a variety of means. So there have been, you know, statutory attempts to do this, be it through in the banking industry or actually even in media markets where there have been statutory caps that have been set to ensure media diversity. This has also been done through rulemaking and regulation by the administrative agencies, and then also ultimately through consent decrees and judicial remedies. So I think each of those options is there. I do think it gets to this, you know, underlying question also relating to the business model. So is there a world in which we don't want these, you know, companies that are effectively functioning as public spheres and infrastructure for how people are accessing information, do we really want those to have behavioral ad-based business models? And so I think partly this is a question of market structure, but it's also intimately a question of business model, which there's also legal precedent for vis-a-vis, you know, lawmakers deciding that for these types of businesses, we don't want them to have, you know, this type of predatory or extractive business model.
Thank you. Ethan, can you...
Let me build on that a little bit. So Lina did just a brilliant job of sort of outlining some of the dynamics of the ad ecosystem. I would point out that there's a special class of businesses that we see a ton of online, which end up functioning as two-sided markets. They aggregate a set of buyers, they aggregate a set of different sellers. Probably the best known of these markets is Amazon, where sometimes you're buying from Amazon, sometimes you're buying from any number of other people selling through Amazon. And one of the things that I think people have realized is that this is a very challenging market position because there's all sorts of informational advantages. Amazon can look at this and say, oh, here's the most attractive sector of the market. That's where we're going to start producing new goods. It's the same thing with Google and advertising. Google has this perspective from running that market of bringing together advertisers and eyeballs where they can look and decide where they want to intervene within the market. It is possible that we want to take the whole class of two-sided markets and treat them in a certain way where we essentially prohibit them from being in businesses where they're acting within that market. That would not be an unreasonable way to sort of think of regulating spaces. The second thing is that these extractive models, Lina talked about this as behavioral targeting. I tend to refer to this as surveillance advertising. I think it's drawing a distinction between types of advertising in which you are not collecting huge amounts of data about the user, but are operating on something else, right? So we have contextual advertising where you sort of say, this is an article about sailboats. Who would like to advertise on an article about sailboats? That's not especially harmful. You can do user-directed advertising. I am searching for information about sailboats. Send me information about sailboats. What gets tricky is when you say, Ethan, you are a 48-year-old single man, it's time for you to buy a sailboat, right? You know, somehow based on where you've been roaming around the internet, And based on the fact that we've combined information from 50 different sources, some online, some offline, and we've now created a behavioral profile, and you know, all of this for a largely unregulated market, we might decide that we don't want that to be a primary business model online. There are people who are abolitionists around that model and simply say we just shouldn't do it. I believe we should tax the crap out of it. I think we should throw a Paul Romer styled penalty tax on it, where we start collecting a significant amount of money for that part of businesses. And we raise the tax over time to try to wean people down to less extractive markets. And then what I think we actually should do with that money is try building infrastructures that are not centered on this broken business model. All we've really talked about so far in this are different versions of advertising, right? We've talked about how local newspapers are losing advertising. We've talked about how we regulate or don't regulate internet markets. My big emphasis in the space these days is to sort of say that the public sphere is too important to leave it up to the market. It is too important that we be able to have conversations about our politics, about our civics, about our collective future, to simply assume that the market-based solutions are going to be the best solutions to this. We need to actually start investing in the spaces in which we have these conversations. Personally, I think a great place to start investing around this is alternatives for social media. But I think you can make really good cases that having a search engine that is not transparent, not auditable, and has immense amounts of implicit political power is something that needs to be transparent and needs to be a public good. So somewhere in this conversation, I'm sort of hoping that we can shift from the assumption that once we figure out how to make advertising work in a new age for the press, everything's going to be good. I actually think we need to be open to this idea that press functions and conversational functions may be something that we want to take on as a public good, and that we may want to actually go ahead and fund in that fashion.
Yeah, so I actually really want to get back to this point in the next round, because I do think there are going to be questions about like whether there are enough incentives for people to actually create this public service media. But then there's also just the issue of what evil are we trying to solve here? One evil could be concentrations of power and relatedly, but not the same, privacy. But those are distinct questions from the focus of this conference, which is like saving the press or protecting the press. And the question is going to be whether these alternative models are going to be in any way adequate substitutes, or I shouldn't say whether they will do enough ameliorative work that we can say, oh, this is a solution, rather than this is like a nice thing that happens, but this is not like where we're going to be investing our time. But I'd like to come back to that. I want to move to Steve, because Steve has a set of proposals that he's mentioned. One that you mentioned, Steve, yesterday was the tax credits. Repeat that. But there were other solutions that you've worked on. Could you talk to us about it?
Well, just for starters, I agree with what Ethan said, that we have to. I believe strongly that we're not going to be able to solve this problem just by making the market work better. Even though I think what Lina is working on is very valuable, we should do things like that, but we need to confront the fact that this is local news is a civic good to some degree. And we have to confront that in terms of it meaning public policies that help. And we have to confront that in terms of the role of the philanthropic sector. And the nonprofit sector. You know, there's all sorts of big sectors in our economy that we have accepted that it's a mix of for-profit and nonprofit. Healthcare, higher education, K through 12 education. And local news is now one of those sectors. We need to really understand and embrace that. So it needs to be a mix. Now, what do you do about that? What are the riddle? First of all, it's a solvable problem. Like this is a bit of a paradox in that this is an incredibly consequential problem. The threat to democracy is really serious, but it would take about $1 billion or $2 properly targeted to actually solve or at least significantly address the local news crisis, which is actually a pretty small amount in the big scheme of things. If you're talking about, you know, things like climate change or, you know, healthcare, this is a solvable problem in its financial scale. So, you know, we can have a whole other conversation about the role of philanthropy and the nonprofit sector, which I think needs to be really significant. But let's talk about government policy. Now, the riddle, of course, with government policy, if you're trying to directly support local media, is it's the government. And so how do you create a system of subsidies that doesn't endanger editorial independence? And journalists have been worried about that forever. And, you know, my view is it's a very serious question. It shouldn't be dismissed as a frivolous concern, but that there are answers to it and that there have been policies in the past that have done this. And we need to think about what the 21st century analogs are. So, you know, the example that Ethan gave of the postal subsidy, it worked really magnificently well. Why? Well, it was content neutral and it was formulaic. And it subsidized all sorts of crappy newspapers, but we all, you know, they put up with it for the greater good of helping to create a news, you know, a newspaper industry. So I think if you're looking at government policy on this, you want to look at policies that strengthen the nonprofit sector, that change the incentives for the for-profit sector toward investing in journalism, especially on the local level, that create a better local news system than what we had before. Aren't just propping up legacy players that, you know, even in the golden age weren't, you know, doing that much. And that it is both platform agnostic, helps startups, but also helps replant existing news organizations into the community in some cases. So one idea, the one you mentioned, Scott, that we like, and when I say we, it's a group called the Rebuild Local News Coalition, which is a coalition of all sorts of different local news organizations and advocates that have come around to try to develop public policy like this, is the idea of a refundable tax credit for consumers to use to buy a local news subscription or donate to a local news nonprofit. And what we like about this is it is a serious subsidy that would help prop up the public good, but it doesn't involve someone at the Commerce Department making decisions about which newspapers ought to get a grant from the Trump administration or the Biden administration. It's a little like the charitable deduction in the sense that the government is enhancing the consumer power as long as it's focused on local news. So we can talk about other ideas. I can go on and on, but that's, I think, one of the exciting ones. I think a second, you know, obviously we at Report for America think that this national service model is a big deal. We're gonna have 1,000 reporters in the field in the next few years. And we think it's a very scalable targeted model for getting journalists in the field. And I think the other topic is this notion of replanting. We're very excited about startups. Report for America is a startup, but there's 6,700 newspapers out there. And we should also be having the conversation of, are there public policy ways of taking some of those 6,700 newspapers, converting them to nonprofit status or to public benefit corporations that are community-based, and essentially replanting them in a situation where the ownership structure doesn't warp their decision-making and where the capital structure doesn't suck the capital out of the community to a hedge fund.
Yeah, the idea of replanting is so interesting. I was wondering if you could just maybe just mention, like, why is it so hard in the United States to convert a news organization or a local newspaper or something like that into a nonprofit? Like, what's the bar to it?
It's getting easier, by the way. There's been some steps that the IRS has done recently that makes it seem like maybe it won't be so hard. But in the past, there's been this really twisted logic at the IRS that stems from the law, which is that you could not, when you're applying to the IRS, say that the public purpose that we're applying for to get tax exempt status was journalism. Journalism wasn't considered a valid public purpose in the IRS's calculations. You had to actually hide it. I know people who, like, their lawyers said, cross out the word journalism and say you're an educational entity because you're educating the public, or because you bring school children into the newsroom and give them free subscriptions or something like that. So for years now, journalism entities have been cobbling together pitches to the IRS that fit the educational category of 501c3 instead of journalism per se being valid. And there are other things that they put in there, like if you're doing something that is equivalent to what a commercial entity is, you can't get tax exempt status. Well, that doesn't make sense. So there are some legal changes that could make it a little bit easier. But right now, it seems to be much less of a problem than it was even 5 years ago.
So that was really informative. Thank you. I'm going to read out a question from an anonymous attendee, which is on point, which is, can ad-based surveillance business models sustainably coexist with journalism? That is, the idea here would be, as I take the question, is that the problem isn't so much the duopoly, it's that the attention economy is just not set up for serious public interest journalism. That's the challenge. Lina, any thoughts about that?
Sure. I mean, it's a really great and important question. I do think Ethan's earlier point is really important about, you know, ensuring that we're distinguishing between different types of ad-based business models. So there's the kind of, you know, surveillance-based model, but then you have contextual advertising, types of advertising that are less invasive. I also think there's a difference between, you know, the type of business model that is or is not appropriate for the two-sided platforms and the type of business model that is or is not appropriate for news publishers. I think the serious perversity occurs when it's the platforms that have this surveillance-based ad model, which is determining their incentives vis-a-vis what types of news they are or are not amplifying. And so insofar as their incentive is to keep more users on the platform, and that corresponds to promoting, you know, sensational news, inflammatory news, hate speech, I think that's where we most frontally run into the problem. I think, you know, types of digital advertising for publishers could be quite appropriate. I think insofar as you can have, you know, contextual advertising and non-surveillance-based advertising. But I think those attention issues and the incentives that surveillance-based companies have are the serious problem. I did briefly also want to just respond to something Steve said. I totally take his point that, you know, we need to embrace local news as a civic good that we need to fund through philanthropies and outside of the market. I do think this is really a question of how much do we want to focus just on post-distribution, assuming that they're going to just be these huge asymmetries, versus also wanting to focus on pre-distribution questions, right? Are we comfortable saying, okay, Mark Zuckerberg, okay, Larry Page, we're gonna let you amass your monopoly fortunes, which are built off of extracting from publishers, but we're just gonna ask that you redistribute that a little bit to ensure that we have local news? Or do we wanna really address the underlying business model and the monopoly issues that are allowing them to amass those monopoly profits in the first place? So I think, you know, there's totally a world in which we recognize this as a public good, as a civic good, invest in it. But insofar as we see these enormous fortunes that are built through, you know, extractive and predatory business practices, I think it's worth rectifying those as well.
I totally agree with that, Lena. I think it has to be both.
Ethan, do you have thoughts?
Well, I mean, Scott, in some ways, I'm a little uncomfortable with your last pushback on me, which was basically suggesting that talking about the public spaces is sort of not part of this conversation, and sort of suggesting that that's about.
I was just saying that was a that was a setup for your answer.
Well, So, look, we've been having this conversation at this conference for 15 years now. And, you know, the good news is that some better solutions are coming to the fore. We're getting more sophisticated about thinking about public benefit corporations and sort of nonprofit conversion. I think the tax credit that Stephen is talking about is thoughtful and worth pursuing and worth considering. I still think we're not dealing with some of the core issues here. The ways in which attention are distributed in the media ecosystem is entirely different than it was 20 years ago. The large broadcast properties, whether they're newspapers or whether they're television broadcasters, are vastly less powerful in terms of figuring out how to direct attention. And the people who are powerful now are search engines and social media. And so, you know, yes, it would be great if these newsrooms, particularly local newsrooms, are better supported and have a better chance of doing their job. If they continue to lose audience, which is what's happening, right? That they are in many cases losing those regular subscribers, losing the share of attention that they used to have, there is the danger that we only retain some of the functions that we're sort of looking for out of journalism. There's an ongoing debate that having that sort of scrutiny of power, if no one's paying attention to it, loses that sort of scrutiny. So I guess what I just want to ask is, I think this way of talking about the program is way too narrowly focused. I don't think simply fixing the fiscal viability of news is enough to actually deal with this larger question of the power and the import of the press. And so I'm trying to make the claim, which may be somewhat radical, that if we are simply talking about saving local journalism, saving national level journalism, saving investigative journalism, we actually run the danger of missing the point, that we end up with better journalism, but we don't end up with that function that we want journalism to serve in the public sphere, unless we think about those questions of information discovery at the same time. You know, the flip side is I may well be wrong on this, and this is sort of my set of obsessions, and I suspect that, you know, Steve in particular may feel differently about this, but
I agree. I did totally want to push back on that. Ethan, no, you're saying we can't only look at subsidies for local news, and I'm saying we can't only look at the issues you're talking about, and we can't only look at the issues Lena's talking about. The obvious answer is we need to look at all three, and that any sensible approach to this issue has to look at the power imbalances, has to look at the poor, you know, attention demand issues that you're talking about, and has to directly subsidize and deal with the business models of local news. That if you don't do all three, you're not gonna solve it.
So I just say that absolutely, I did put it in a provocative way because I was intending to provoke. So let me provoke even further. Why do you? The project that you have been developing in this set of thoughts that you've been proposing is the idea that we should be creating more publics, I think you call it public service media, akin to like the paradigm being Wikipedia, which is one of the great successes, seems in human knowledge. And as you actually point out, that before Trump and everything, when we talked about the problem of disinformation, we pointed to Wikipedia. And now it's now like when we want to fact check, we use Wikipedia. So it's been like a real dramatic change in this really vital resource. But when I'm sure you've gotten this pushback, and let me just push back on you. Like Wikipedia is a very unusual thing, and it has its own set of issues. But why assume that there will be incentive for, or let me put it another way, how do we, what policy levers can we use in order to help foster public service media?
Yeah, so the term I use is actually digital public infrastructure, which has a lot of very different implications from public service media. I'm actually not interested in subsidizing content. I'm actually interested in trying to find ways to invest in infrastructures that a wide variety of people could use to try to address these problems. So let me give you an example of this. I'm working with a small chain of newspapers in the Mountain West of the US. These are weekly newspapers that generally serve communities of 5,000 and under. They are really interested in seeing whether they can benefit their readers and actually attract more subscribers by hosting conversational spaces around their news. But they also know that they don't want to do this on Facebook or somewhere else. They want to have control over the conversation. They want to moderate. They sort of want to build with that. There's a surprisingly scarce amount of solutions for them to work with, because in many ways, the work on sort of digital public spheres has largely been abandoned because the assumption is that Facebook, Twitter et al. Are going to sort of take care of it. So one way to do this is to sort of say, you need both investment in the technology and then you need the community investment in it. Wikipedia relies very, very heavily on huge amounts of donated labor, but it also relies on professional technological infrastructure development, which is what donations to Wikipedia end up supporting. So you have professional grade infrastructure and then you have people sort of building atop it. I think similarly, if you had really good infrastructure for building these sorts of conversations, this newspaper chain can sort of go out and host those conversations, have the reporters and the editors who really want to be part of those community conversations be some of the labor that's ending up hosting those, and potentially do something that ends up giving you more subscribers to the newspaper. I don't think the way to do this, at least in the space that I'm talking about, is subsidizing the content. I think that starts getting very, very tricky. But I think much in the same way that when the US started moving towards public broadcasting models, an enormous amount of the federal investment was around things like satellite connectivity and sort of trying to make sure that those different players within the PBS network would be able to share content and sort of broadcast it across the board. So where I'd really love to see us invest is in building out tool sets that everything from local newspapers to local governments to coffee shops can be bringing up to have a very different vision for social media and social networks, with the assumption that some sort of combination of cross-subsidy work, i.e. private businesses supporting these spaces because it gets people to use their product, and perhaps public investment moves people away from some existing networks and into a different set of spaces.
I mean, are you imagining just kind of the creation of some kind of content management system that's open source or something like that? Is that the kind of infrastructure you mean?
I mean, we're actively building this, so it's not imagining. I mean, I'm building software around Mastodon that, you know, this newspaper chain is likely to deploy in the near future. And I'm building client systems around this as well to let people sort of interface with these networks. So it's really just a question of investment. We have huge chunks of our public sphere that we have systemically underinvested in because we assume that the market has solved the problem. What we have instead are market solutions that are bad for us. They're bad for us civically, they're bad for us commercially. And so we backed away from solving them. And because of the ways that that market is structured, it's very hard to move into that market commercially. If you go out and look for VC funding, the first question you're gonna get asked is, how are you gonna get to 3 billion users and compete with Facebook? You don't want 3 billion users to actually have a public sphere. There is no functional 3 billion user public sphere. These public spheres are probably somewhere between 20 and 20,000 users. How do you build spaces for conversation around that? Local newspapers, by the way, are a terrific place to build those spaces. But rather than having it be built by someone like Nextdoor, you know, which is doing this through surveillance partnerships and sort of the lens of public safety, do it through a local newspaper, which is actually doing it through a lens of civic engagement and civic involvement, but make sure that we actually have the tools and software to do it. Struggling local newspapers are not going to make a major investment in building new technological platforms to allow these conversations to happen, even if that turns out to be what might end up revitalizing them in the long run. And that's a great place to use public investment around this.
Great, thanks. Steve, did you want to jump in on this?
Yeah, I think that sounds great. I really do. I'm not being sarcastic. I think that's, you know, this is a huge lost opportunity of why, you know, everything from, you know, Craigslist to Facebook wasn't done on a community level by the local news organizations themselves. They viewed themselves as content providers instead of community institutions. If you view yourself as a community institution, then the idea of holding conversations becomes very logical to do what Ethan's talking about. But there was an interesting word that Ethan used in his example. The word was reporter. And what we have found is, you know, there's been a 60% drop in the number of reporters in America. That's on the same scale as the collapse of the coal industry. And the problem is that generating discussion actually is much cheaper than generating reporting. So you can have platforms that do great work at, I mean, in a way, this is what we're seeing with Nextdoor. Nextdoor is actually an effective means of generating discussion in a lot of communities, but it's not being used to support reporting. And you have some elements of where there will always be an inevitable conversation somewhere along the line where the finance guy goes to the CEO of this company and says, you know, this thing you have over here with the community that draws in 10 times as many users as the reporting and costs a fraction of subsidizing, of running the reporting, that's so much better of a business. Why don't we just do that? And why don't we stop this ridiculous cross subsidy of the community subsidizing the journalism and just have this better ROI? And that is why I think it has to be both the types of stuff that Ethan is talking about, where you're using better public infrastructure to empower news organizations to be community institutions, and you need some form of direct subsidies for the most labor-intensive types of journalism.
Great. So I want to turn to another question from the audience from Sita Gengadaran. I hope I pronounced that correctly. Coming back to the hedge fund issue, maybe one area for consideration is to constrain the financialization in the news industry. I'm not sure what that would look like, but it strikes me policy should have been targeted this decade ago. Are any of Stephen's remedies tackling this? So first, Stephen, and I know Lina has something to jump.
I'm gonna tell you what I've learned on this, but it's skin deep. And I think there are probably people in the audience who know more about this, and I encourage them to think about this. I used to work at the FCC. The FCC had a guiding principle that either did or was supposed to infuse all their decisions, which was localism, if it hurt the local community. So what I've been told by, you know, smart antitrust lawyers is that there is no reason that the US Department of Justice couldn't right now say that newspaper mergers that harm localism won't be allowed. By harm local, and not just in a, you know, there's less competition or the prices will go up or something like that, but literally in terms of whether there's less journalism and less information in a community, that value is one that already could be applied through existing antitrust law. So that it wouldn't really solve the problems of the consolidation that's already happened, but it's a really interesting thought about how it could prevent future consolidation or financialization of local news.
Lina?
Sure, and I think, it's interesting. I mean, I think the financialization and consolidation are slightly separate issues which intersect, and I think we might have different remedies for different ones. And you're absolutely right. I mean, even within a current consumer welfare framework, potential decrease of output, of journalistic output, would certainly be a basis on which to block newspaper mergers. And I think traditionally even reviews of newspaper mergers have actually been more sympathetic to bringing some of these external values to bear relating to media plurality and that sort of thing. I was just pointing out that there are some legislative models for what trying to de-financialize a particular industry could look like. And this also goes back to Scott's earlier question as to how do we actually do this? So I'd mentioned in the chat the Public Utility Holding Company Act of 1935, which was basically responding to the fact that public utility companies had basically become these elaborate investment vehicles and very speculative, and that was coming at the expense of their ability to actually just provide reliable energy to Americans. And so you had this law that basically required public utility companies to register with the SEC to actually function as a utility. And in order to get that licensing, they would have to agree not to engage in speculative financial activity and basically not be able to even have these other kinds of financial holding companies. So there are analogs here. I don't know what it would look like precisely to try and import that in this context, but it is interesting to think about, you know, what are the other instances in which the public has decided that a particular industry or a particular function plays too important a public role for it to be governed by these types of financializations.
That's really interesting.
Thank you. There's a question here in the audience from Smitha Karana, and it's to Ethan. Ethan, thanks for pointing out the limitations of focusing on fiscal models and the challenges of preserving our traditional conceptions of journalism. Do you think we have sufficient research on the way the digital news ecosystem works today, in particular, the way that social platforms and changes in producing journalism have redefined communities and audiences?
I really appreciate that question. It's the simple answer to this, right? So my area of study is sort of media ecosystems, right? So this relationship between journalistic media and other forms of media like social media. I think we had sort of the first, you know, masterwork in the field with Yochai Benkler's network propaganda, which was an analysis of the 2016 elections, where he and his team looked at the ways in which sort of extremist right-wing media that was sort of digitally native ended up pulling Fox News to the right, and with it pulling the New York Times and sort of the center of political media ecosystems, and effectively set the agenda for what was going to be talked about in the 2016 elections. I think even that book is now out of date because people are now trying to figure out how to influence these conversations, whether directly through social media channels or through that interface between social media and news media. I think beyond that, this field's really hard to work in and study because we have very few resources to study ecosystems as a whole. Not only do we not have great access to how information is being shared on Facebook or on Twitter, we actually have pretty limited tools for figuring out how do you look at news media as a whole swath and sort of ask a question of what's happening across local news versus what's happening within sort of nationally focused news. I recently published a paper with Elizabeth Henson Shapiro about new ways that researchers are trying to squeeze information out of the platforms to sort of go ahead and look at these things. But the reason I'm being insistent to the point of stridency in this conversation is that I fear that over the long durée of talking about how we help journalism and how we help the future of newspapers, the target keeps shifting. And I think at this point, if we're not really actively going after this question of how do ideas spread online and what's the intersection of these participatory platforms and these journalistic platforms in setting agenda, in hosting conversations, in shaping opinion, I worry that our solutions, you know, end up sort of missing where the ball is at present.
Thank you. I guess I would, I'd like to kind of end up by just asking for predictions. What do we think, what do you think the most likely intervention will be in the next couple of years in terms of trying to either prop up, protect the press function, or the Ethan's idea of enlarging the public sphere, digital public sphere. Do you want to put down some bets, Lina?
Yeah, it's a great question. I mean, I don't know. I mean, I think there are some interesting efforts underway right now. There have been efforts, actually a bipartisan effort in Congress right now, to think about whether there should be an antitrust exemption created for news publishers, which would basically allow them to collectively bargain with the platforms in order to be able to get better remuneration for their content. This is, you know, a rough analog to what Australia is moving towards. So it'll be interesting to see if that gains any traction, given that there does seem to be some bipartisan interest. The antitrust lawsuits against both Google and Facebook will continue to proceed, although antitrust litigation is notoriously protracted. But you know, the states have requested that Google be broken up, that Facebook be broken up. You know, how sympathetic a judge would actually be in terms of granting those remedies is an open question. But at least in the ad tech space, I think if we did end up seeing a breakup of Google's, you know, positions all across the ad tech business, it would be interesting to see, you know, what effect that could potentially have. These are, of course, you know, the market-based solutions. I don't know what's, you know, if there are proposals to be investing more publicly or more, you know, civic and philanthropic investments, but that'll obviously be something to keep an eye on too.
Do we know of any, do we know whether any of the $1.9 trillion that is going out to America is going at all to any media organizations?
Very little. 130 million or so is going to the Corporation for Public Broadcasting. Some of that will go to public radio and public TV stations that do local journalism. About $1 billion of it is going to public health advertising around vaccination. I am calling on the administration, and I hope everyone else will, to say, hey, instead of spending all that money on Facebook and Google, how about if some of it was spent as advertising in community news organizations and newspapers? That would be a good thing. No additional money needed. Just you know, think local instead of social or national. But other than that, there's not targeted funding.
Steve, do you want to just give us a quick prediction?
Well, it's always a total long shot for anything really constructive to be done through Congress. So with that caveat, I would say there's more of a chance in this Congress that there's going to be actual discussions about actual policies that on all of the different things we've talked about, the balance of power between media and the platforms, social infrastructure, and direct support for you know, nonprofit journalism in this Congress. There's all sorts of signs for that. So I think now's the time for everyone to really start, you know, pay attention to public policy on this. This is the year or two when it's going to come to a head. And the other thing I would say is that a lot of interesting stuff happening on the philanthropic side. Report for America, you know, has this model where we put in half the subsidized, half the salary, and then we ask the newsroom to raise money from the community for their half. We've seen in the last year a dramatic increase in the success of our 200 partner newsrooms in what they can raise from the community. So community foundations are getting activated. They're starting to see that the health of a community, which they're, you know, paying attention to, has to involve information health as well. So there's a lot of creativity and energy happening on the philanthropic side.
Ethan, can you take us out?
News is a rounding error for companies like Facebook and Google. We care enormously about their impact in our field. For the most part, when you talk to people within Facebook and Google, they wish they could simply get news off their platforms. It does not drive a lot of their traffic, and it drives 90% of their problems. When you hear Mark Zuckerberg talk about a pivot to privacy, it's his desire to be entirely content neutral. He doesn't want to know whether news is going back and forth, whether it's polarized, whether it's false or misinformation, so on and so forth. So I actually think, you know, sort of what we've seen in Australia may be the beginnings of a disentanglement. I think there is a sense in which Facebook in particular sort of feels like this is the bee's hive that it did not mean to step into, and maybe it's time for it to extricate itself from it. I don't think Google is going to go down the same path. I think news is much closer to what Google does, at least as a search engine. And I think as a content provider on YouTube, I think they're going to remain tied together there. But I would not be surprised if, as this conversation changes over time, we see some of the big players in it actively trying to divest news from their portfolios because of its social importance and the ways in which it ends up being incredibly problematic.
That's interesting.
Wow, thank you so much. That was a crazy good panel. Thank you. I really appreciate it. And we will take a 15-minute break, and we will reconvene at 1:30. But I want to thank Steve, Ethan, and Lina for a fantastic panel. Thank you.
Thanks for hosting, Scott.
Thank you.
Thank you.